and clean and vibrant. Well, let's look together at the Word of God. We're looking at John chapter 11. We've been journeying together with People Matter to Jesus. And that's part of why the flags are up. We have a new set of flags just to remind us that there are other places that Jesus cares about. He cares about people. And He cares about people here in Canada and all around the world. He cares about people in a variety of situations and circumstances. And today we're going to look at John chapter 11, verse 33 and 35. It says, when Jesus saw her weeping, this is Mary, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, He was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? That's Lazarus. He asked, come see, Lord, they replied. And then the shortest verse in the Bible, Jesus wept. Heavenly Father, we bow our heads together in our hearts. And we pray, O Lord, as we look at the fact that You care about those whose lives have been touched with grief. We think of this family that Maggie was praying for. We think of the Maniego family. We think of many families, many friends, Lord, that we know have come and faced this kind of sorrow from time to time. And we pray, O Lord, that in those moments we will see that the God of the mountain is the God of the valley, and that You are faithful and true. And so, Lord, we pray that as we look together, You would encourage our hearts and souls in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this week, about 325 people gathered within these walls to pay their final respects to Jackie Maniego. Such services are valuable because they help family members and friends grieve. We find comfort and closure in the midst of great emotion. Unfortunately, we live in a fallen world. And each and every day, families around the world, around the Lower Mainland for that matter, say goodbye to someone that they love. We don't have to live very long before we realize that grief and pain are part of the human experience. It's interesting that God does not shield us from such sorrow, but He allows us to experience grief and loss. But in the midst of that, He also promises to be our source of comfort. Blessed are those who mourn, Jesus said, for they will be comforted. Many who have gone through such pain, the pain of grief, the pain of loss, have found Jesus to be their rock and their fortress. They have found Jesus to be the source of great comfort. And yet there's others. Others that in the midst of this grieving, in the midst of the loss, have become disappointed or disillusioned with God for not preventing the occasion that precipitated their mourning. Sometimes it's okay to admit that we don't have all the answers to why things happen in life, nor do we understand why they happen as they do. However, deep down in the very depths of my soul, I believe that people matter to Jesus. And I believe that He is touched by their grief and their pain, and that somehow matters. That's why the author of the Hebrews could say this. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet without sin. Let us approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we might receive mercy and find grace and help in our time of need. So what does Jesus want those who are touched with grief from time to time to understand? I think He wants them to understand that He cares and that He loves. And perhaps we can find some perspective this morning from the story of how Jesus responds to those who have gathered to grieve the loss of His dear friend, Lazarus. The first thing about the story of Lazarus that I want us to understand is that Jesus doesn't always behave like we expect Him or want Him to behave. Now, of course, that creates this problem for us For when we have an expectation of how we think God should act or how we think Jesus should act, and he acts differently, then there's room for us to become embittered or angry at God. And so it's important for us to understand that sometimes Jesus doesn't always act the way we would like him to act. Now, a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, a village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sister sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one who you love is sick." It's very clear. It's very clear that these siblings were very precious to Jesus. He and his disciples had been guests previously in their home. Remember how Martha, who's the oldest and seems to be the one holding the family together, maybe the parents, they're not mentioned. Who knows what happened to them? Maybe they're no longer with them. But she was a little upset with her younger sister, Mary, for not helping with the preparations. After all, that's a lot of mouths to feed Jesus and all his disciples. And Jesus gently reminds her of what's really important. And sometimes we get so busy doing that we neglect simply sitting at Jesus' feet. But as such, they had an opportunity to hear Jesus teach. They had an opportunity to observe him and talk with him and laugh with him while he was off duty. Their love for Jesus was genuine. And there's no doubt that they believed. Just listen to the words of Martha. "Yes, Lord," she told him, "I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God who has come into the world." And so when Lazarus was sick, they knew exactly what to do. Send word to Jesus. Surely when Jesus hears that Lazarus, his dear friend, is sick, he'll just drop everything and come here and heal him. I can just hear the conversation, can't you? As Mary and Martha have those cold compresses and they're gently patting Lazarus' head and trying to comfort him. "Lazarus, don't worry. Don't worry, Lazarus. We've sent for Jesus. He should be here shortly. Lazarus, everything will be okay." And I wonder if that's kind of what was going on in their hearts and minds. And I don't think it's too far for us to say that that's probably what was happening within those hearts of those girls. But everything wasn't okay. And what happens then when everything isn't okay in our lives? What happens when we have this expectation and Jesus isn't quite working the way we want him to work? Jesus hadn't arrived yet. And Lazarus takes a turn for the worst. There's no word from Jesus yet. There's no text message or anything. Had he even got their message? They didn't know, but now it's too late. Lazarus takes his last breath. And the reality of this situation hits Mary and Martha like a ton of bricks. Lazarus is gone. And their lives would forever be changed. Perhaps some wonder, well, why is this happening? After all, Lazarus was Jesus' dear friend, one whom Jesus loved. I notice how the old enemy often comes in these moments of sorrow and grief, and he has a field day with us, bringing doubt and accusation, especially when things don't go the way we desired them to go. Some begin to question the very existence of God, or at least his power to heal or to restore. But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind not have kept this man from dying?" What kind of man is Jesus? Couldn't he have done this? And they begin to question the very character of Jesus, and they begin to question whether or not he was able to do the miraculous. And sometimes the old enemy would love for us to get into a place where we begin to question the goodness of God, the character of God, the caring of God, the power of God. Maybe Jesus doesn't care for you as much as you thought, the old devil might whisper. After all, shouldn't he be here by now? Notice how when Jesus finally does come, both Mary and Martha say the same thing. Lord, Martha said, if you had been here, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. And later, when Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Obviously, it wasn't due to a lack of faith that caused Lazarus' death. However, that's often what the enemy of our souls begins to tell us. I remember I was about 14 years old and our church called an emergency prayer meeting to intercede for the life of one of its members who was dying. Yet despite our fervent prayers, she died. That's really hard on some people. Several people struggled a lot with that. Some questioned those very things that we just mentioned. Is God real? Does God really even love us? Is God able? Thankfully, I had some parents that helped a young 14-year-old process these things. They talked about the ultimate healing that a believer receives in heaven and how that can be an answer to prayer. But they also helped me to see that it takes great faith to believe that our trials and our pain and our grief can ultimately bring glory to God, even when we don't quite understand it now. And when he heard this, that Lazarus was sick, Jesus says, this sickness will not end in death. No, it's for the glory of God so that God's Son might be glorified through it. Jesus loved Martha and her sister Mary and Lazarus. And when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. Do you think that if Mary and Martha had just a bit more faith, that Jesus would have come right away? If they had just a bit more faith, would Jesus have come right away? And yet sometimes that's what we hear. If we just kind of can muster up just a bit more faith. Did Jesus stay away because there was sin in Lazarus' life? Or that somehow he was unworthy? Well, I think the answer to those questions are no. It's more possible that Jesus had a plan. And Jesus had a purpose that neither Mary, Martha, or Lazarus, for that matter, were aware of. And I wonder in my life, and I wonder in our lives, when we face grief and sorrow and pain, and we wish we didn't have to. And the old devil's coming and just kind of bombarding our heart and soul and mind with doubt or with guilt. Because we didn't have enough faith, or we weren't obedient enough, or we weren't this, or we weren't that. I wonder if Jesus has a plan. And I wonder if he has a purpose. After he had said this, he went on to tell them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going to wake him up, he says. His disciples replied, Lord, if he sleeps, that will be better. You know, if he's really sick, just some sleep would be good for him, Jesus. But Jesus had been speaking of his death, and his disciples thought that he meant natural sleep. So he told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. And for your sakes, I'm glad I was not there so that you might believe, but let us go to him. And so Jesus was not acting in a way that we had anticipated, nor is he rushing to their aid as quickly as Mary and Martha had hoped. But we need to remember that he is still able to work things out according to his purpose and his plan. He works them out so that he might be glorified in the midst of that situation. And you know, I have often prayed that prayer when I find myself asking the why questions. Lord, why is this happening? Why are we going through this? Why is this happening? Did I do something? You know, I've often began to pray, Lord, would you be glorified in the midst of this situation? Would you glorify yourself? Would you redeem? Would you restore? A Christian blacksmith was suffering great affliction. And when an unbeliever said, how could a God, a loving God that you serve, allow you to suffer so much? What do you say to that? The blacksmith says, oh, I'm a blacksmith. I often take a piece of iron and I bring it to white heat. And then I take it to the anvil and I hit it a few times with the hammer. I want to see if it will take a temper. Is this pliable or will the metal crack under pressure? If it's pliable, then I plunge it in the water and then back into the fire. And I do this many times. Fire. Boom, boom. Fire. And I do this process until finally I have a useful tool I can use for years to come. But if I put it in the fire and I hit it and the metal cracks and I realize it won't take a temper, I take that and I throw it into the scrap heap. It can never be of any service. And he said, I believe the Lord is making me into something of use in his kingdom. And so I pray, Lord, put me in the fire if thou wilt. Put me in the water if I need it. Do anything, dear Lord, but don't throw me into the scrap heap. Make me and use me in thy service. So sometimes we don't know why Jesus does what he does, but we do know this, that he can be glorified in the midst of that very situation. The second thing we learn from this story is that Jesus is touched by our grief. Throughout the story, John, who's writing the gospel, makes sure that everyone who's reading knows beyond a shadow of a doubt that Jesus loves this family. He's also let the readers in on a secret that Mary and Martha don't know, that he has come back now to raise Lazarus from the dead, and that Jesus knew that this day would have a very happy ending. However, at the very moment before Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead, things weren't all that happy. Word comes that Jesus is on the edge, coming into the city, coming into the town. And when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him. But Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask. That's great faith, isn't it? She approaches Jesus. She's troubled. She's puzzled. Why had he not come before now? But she doesn't appear to be embittered. Rather, she seems to be full of faith. Mary, on the other hand, stays home. We're not told why. Was she angry? Was she simply overcome with grief? Well, the text doesn't tell us. However, she does respond when Martha informs her that Jesus is here and wants to see her. And after she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. The teacher is here, she said, and he's asking for you. And when Mary heard this, she got up and went quickly to meet him. Now when Jesus had not entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing that she had gone to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was, she saw him, and she fell at his feet and said, O Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come see, Lord, they replied. Jesus wept. Upon seeing the depth of Mary and Martha's grief, Jesus was moved, and he begins to weep as well. So why does he weep? Why does Jesus weep? He knows the outcome is going to be good. He knows that this is going to be a day of celebration. He knows this is going to be a day of rejoicing. He knows this is going to be a day of praise. So why does he weep in this moment? Some suggest that he is moved at the grief that is part of the human experience, and that he's touched by the reality of sickness and death. Something that he would take, of course, his own death and resurrection to conquer. Where, O death, is your victory? O where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And so for those who believe in Jesus, there's victory over this thing called death. And while certainly that's true, gloriously true, do you think that Jesus was simply touched by the pain, the depth of pain that he saw his dear friends bearing? And I can't help but wonder, how many times has Jesus come alongside of you and I in those moments of great grief, when we are beside ourselves in sorrow, and Jesus comes and gives us one of those divine hugs and lets us know that He is with us in body and presence. And we just sense His power of comfort and grace. I love the little story of the little boy in the doctor's office. He's playing there, his mom is there at the doctor's office, and while he's waiting, he notices an elderly man who's waiting for his wife, who's seeing the doctor. She's very ill, not expected to live much longer, and the boy notices a tear escape from the man's eye. It makes its way down the cheek. Instantly, the boy climbs on the man's lap and hugs him tight, you know, like a little kid can do. Hugs him tight just for about a minute or so, and then returns to play. The mother was curious, calls her son over, "Honey, what were you doing with that man?" "Oh, nothing, Mom. I was just helping him cry." And I wonder how often Jesus will come in those moments and just help us cry. In the scripture, we are encouraged as believers to rejoice with those who rejoice and to weep or mourn with those who mourn. And I can't help but think that if Jesus encourages His sons and daughters to do that, that He would not Himself do that. And I find great comfort in knowing then that when we face these trials and tests that we would rather not ever face, that Jesus will say to us, "By the way, you don't have to face them alone. I will be with you. And I will strengthen you. And I will uphold you." Is there a reason why passages such as that are precious to us? Or is there a reason why some of the Psalms are so precious to us? Because in them, the very words of Scripture, we find the strength that we know that Jesus is with us. The last thing I see about this passage is that Jesus is willing to reveal great truths about Himself. Jesus said to her, "Martha, your brother will rise again." And Martha answered, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." And Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Well, yes, Lord," she told him. "I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who has come into the world." What a tremendous truth was revealed in that very moment. A tremendous truth. "I am the resurrection and the life." What a great truth. "Whoever believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die." Glorious truth. Jesus is the source of life, not only here on earth, but the life that is to come. And all who are in Christ will never die, for He is the one who gives eternal life. William Barclay says, "Even if a man is dead in sin, even if through his sin he has lost all that makes life worth calling life, Jesus says, I can make him alive again." Have you ever noticed in your life how many of God's great revelations of Himself come in those very moments of frustration? The great revelations of who He is come in those very moments of disappointment or even bewilderment to God. You see, He's not intimidated. He's not intimidated by my inability to grasp what He's doing. He's not intimidated by my inability to understand His ways. He just simply says, "Will you trust me? Will you trust me? Will you trust me even when it feels silly?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "Oh, but Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there's a bad odor, for he has been dead. He's been there for 4 days. Remember, this is Martha. This is the one who said, "But I know even now God will give you whatever you ask." Saying, "But Lord, don't you realize? And as the King James says, he stinketh. Jesus, this is a bad idea. And I wonder how often in those moments Jesus speaks to us and reveals a glorious truth and says, will you trust me in this moment? And we say, Jesus, this is a really bad idea. And Jesus simply asks us to trust him. But our logic, which makes perfect sense to us, hinders us from obeying. And Jesus speaks clearly. Just roll the stone away from the tomb. Watchman Nee, in the book A Table for in the Wilderness, says it is always good to have a mountain to the left and to a right, an enemy behind and a sea in front, for then faith has its opportunity. One great hindrance to faith is a lack of need. If God blesses you with need, he'll bless you with faith. And faith works best when in really desperate need. I kind of like what he says, isn't it? If God blesses you with need, he will bless you with faith. Jesus says, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? And so they took away the stone. Sometimes Jesus needs to just encourage us. Sometimes Jesus needs to just remind us. Listen, I can be glorified in the very midst of this situation. Would you just respond? Would you just obey? And so they rolled away the stone. How much faith was needed in that moment? Enough to obey. Enough to roll away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you've heard me. And I know that you always hear me. But I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they might believe that you sent me. And when he said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And I forgot to do it. I was going to get somebody to, roll it up in toilet paper or something. Wouldn't that have been fun? And then when I said that, they could come out the door. Lazarus, come forth. And the dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with the strips of linen and the cloth around his face. And Jesus said, take off the grave clothes and let him go. Now, I don't know what Lazarus thought while he was dying. He obviously knew that word had been sent to Jesus. However, right here in this very moment, I see him responding to Jesus' voice, even if it meant he had a hobble in his grave clothes. Now, this story is truly amazing. And it didn't happen every day. In fact, it only happened 10 times in the entire Bible where people were raised from the dead. 9 times where people raised from the dead only to die again. There's Elijah with the widow's son that she fed Elijah. There's Elisha with the son of the Shunammite. There's Elisha's tomb where the guy died and they chucked him into the cave and he landed on Elijah's bones and he came to life. There's Jesus raising Jairus' daughter. There's Jesus seeing the widow from Nain and the funeral procession and he goes over, he's moved with compassion and he raises her son. There's Lazarus here. There are the people that are raised from the dead when Jesus is risen from the dead. And many others that were dead were seen walking around because the power of the resurrection just touched them. There's Dorcas that Peter is part of, and Paul, Eutychus, the guy that fell asleep in church. It's always dangerous to fall asleep in church. But all these will die a second time, but then there was the 10th one, and that's Jesus. And he is the resurrection and the life. And he is the first fruit of new hope. And when he rose from the dead, it was to never die again because death had been conquered. And that's the revelation, isn't it? What a glorious one. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. He doesn't just bring resurrection. He is the source of resurrection. But Christ indeed has been raised from the dead, the first fruit of all those who've fallen asleep. So even when life on earth is difficult, when life on earth is unfair, There is an eternal reward for those who belong to Jesus. So while we might not always understand why we are asked to face pain and grief and sorrow in this life, chances are that at some point in time, we will find ourselves facing it. I would probably be a safe bet, and I'm not a betting man, that there's a funeral going on right now in the city of Vancouver at one of our funeral homes. And that there will be one tomorrow, and one the next day, and one the next day. That there are families, even now, being touched with this. But when those moments come, I hope and I pray that we will remember that Jesus will work and he will move according to his plans and his purposes. And even though I might not understand his ways, I can be assured that he understands his ways and that he will be glorified in the very midst of the situation. I take great comfort in that. I hope and I pray that we will realize that Jesus loves us dearly. That just because we face something we wish we didn't have to face does not mean that he has withheld his gift and his ability to love us. Rather, he is touched and moved by the conditions of our heart. And that in those very moments, he can grant to us the most significant revelations of himself in the very midst of our pain. I know that's true in my life. In the moment of the greatest pain was also a revelation of God's glory and grace in my life. God is able and God is good and God is able to take those moments and turn them into something beautiful. How that old song say? Something beautiful, something good. All my confusion he understood. Takes those things and he uses them for his glory. So do you know Jesus is Savior? I would hate to go through that kind of sorrow. I would hate to go through that kind of grieving. I would hate to go through that kind of heartbreak and not know Jesus. And not know his comfort and not know his grace and not know that he is saying, I am working all things together for good to those who love me and are called according to his purpose. I would not want to face those things not knowing the one who is the resurrection and the life, because he is the one who brings mercy and he is the one who brings grace. Peter says, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept for you in heaven. Do you know Jesus today? Do you know his love and his grace, his comfort, and his strength? Will that prevent you ever facing grief? No. We live in a fallen world, and we all face it. But it will make sure that you don't face that grief alone, because we have a Savior who loves you dearly. Let's bow our heads together. Is there anyone here today and you say, I just need Jesus to come into my life and my heart? Anyone at all? Then maybe you're here today. And maybe unknown to anyone, you are facing sorrow. You are facing grief. Maybe you're facing something that is very painful to you. And you just say, Lord, I just really ask for your presence, for your comfort, your grace. We serve a God who can heal. And we serve a God who can restore. You never know what he will do. And so we in no way want to minimize what God can do. What a great miracle this was. And maybe you need God's touch. Heavenly Father, we bow our heads and our hearts today. We pray, Lord, that you would encourage and you would strengthen and you would move by your power and your grace. And Lord, if there's anyone that's going through a time of grief, maybe a time of doubt, that you would come and you would come and bring assurance, oh Father, of your great presence. Assurance that you are the resurrection and the life, and that you can redeem such things and use them for your glory and your honor. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together. Just before we sing our closing hymn, I want you to understand its context. You can stand. It was 1871. Horatio Spafford was taking his family to assist D.L. Moody in one of the campaigns in Great Britain. However, due to an unexpected business development, he had to stay in Chicago. He would board another ship just a few days later. He sent his wife and his four daughters ahead. But on November 22nd, the ship was struck by another vessel. The ship that his wife and children on sank in 12 minutes. Several days later, the survivors arrived in Wales. Mrs. Spafford cabled her husband. It's the next slide. And I know you can't read it that much, but there's the telegram that says, "Saved alone." Spafford got on board of his ship to join his grieving wife. As the ship neared the area where his four daughters drowned, this man looked over the sea and he began to pen these words. "When peace, like a river, attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul." And it can be well with our souls because we serve a God who cares for people, even those who are touched by grief. Let's sing together.